want to remind everyone that this morning we are going to be singing hymns. We do have to keep our masks on while we're singing, but please sing to your heart's content. All right? We'll be doing the enjoy. You can also join in on the gradual hymn. We're going to do the three hymns that we will be singing will be the processional, the gradual, and the recessional. We will not be singing the service music at this time. That will be added in later on.
And post-communion, too.
And for communion. We also have a hymn for communion that you're welcome to sing as well. So please join us in those opportunities. We're slowly getting things back to where we need to be. Just bear with us as we continue to move forward. I do want to remind you that one thing about the masks is that they're kind of difficult to sing real loudly and robustly. So please limit yourselves. The first time I tried to do this, be quite honest, I got a little lightheaded because I realized I was breathing in a whole lot of carbon dioxide when I was doing it. So please make sure that you know to keep track of where you are, because when the priest starts getting dizzy and starts doing this, it's not good. Also want to remind everyone that in May, this month, we are going to be having our first family dinner all together, but it's going to be outside on the front lawn. It will be May 23rd, that's Pentecost, at 6 p.m. We're going to have barbecue. We're going to have pig pickings. We're going to have barbecue pork. For those, I know there are some people who are not supposed to eat pork. It's not part of their diet, so they can't. So we're going to have baked chicken for them. We're going to have drumsticks for the children if they would like to have those. And we're going to supply the baked beans. So what we're asking everybody else to bring for our additional sides, like maybe coleslaw, salad, whatever you'd like to bring. We're also going to have tea, lemonade, and water. Because we're doing this on the front lawn, very close to Coker, very close to the governor's school, we will not have any alcoholic beverages on the front lawn. That's just part of what we have decided is the vestry. But we don't want to be accused of somebody coming over underage and getting their hands into something they shouldn't. Okay? So please know that you're welcome to invite friends, invite your neighbors. We're going to have tables. Every table we have inside is going to be out there, so people will be able to distance and all those kinds of things. And My Design is also going to provide some music for the event as well. So please come and join us. Please, like I said, invite your neighbors and your friends, and family to come up and join us for that day. And we will be safe and distancing and those kinds of with all of these activities. But that'll be May 23rd, 6 p.m. Are there any other announcements for the good of the community? Have a prayer for today. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you all hearts known, all desires known, and all kingdom secrets are given. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the glory. Glory to God
in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King,
Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated
at the right hand of the Father.
Receive our prayer.
For you alone are the Holy One.
You alone are the Lord.
You alone are the
Most High,
Jesus Christ,
with the Holy Spirit,
in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whom truly to know is everlasting life, grant us so perfectly to know your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated for the beautiful lessons.
Joyful in God, all you lands.
Sing the glory of his name.
Sing the glory of his praise.
Say to God, how awesome are your deeds.
Because of your great strength, your enemies cringe before you.
All the earth bows down before you.
Sing to you, sing out your name.
Come now and see the works of God.
How wonderful he is, doing toward all people.
Turned the sea into dry land, so that they went through the water on foot.
And there we rejoiced in him.
In his might he rules forever. His eyes keep watch over the nations.
Let no rebel rise up against him.
epistle lesson this morning is from 1 John chapter 3, beginning with verse 18. Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. This is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set our hearts at rest in his presence. If our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask, because he keeps his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. The one who keeps God's commands lives in him and he in them. And this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. The word of the Lord.
Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me.
Because I live, you also will live. On that day you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Preaching on the lesson from Acts. And there were several events that occurred in my life that I have told you of before, but they have a very powerful bearing on the actual. So if you remember these stories, that's fine. But I hopefully we'll see them with new eyes. Well, over 30 years ago, Ellen and I were exiting a restaurant with four friends. We were in the Charleston area. And as we exited the restaurant, all of us saw this man who was sitting on the curb. He didn't say anything to us. He didn't make any gestures toward us. And we were moving toward the parking lot or our vehicles. And we stopped to say our goodbyes. And five of us were involved in the conversation, but one of the men that we exited with was looking at this man on the curb. And all of a sudden, he decided to leave our group and go over and talk with this man. And so the five of us are still standing there. He goes over, talks with the man a few moments, and he comes back to us and he says, y'all go ahead and go home. And he turned to his wife and he said, why don't you take her home as well? And he turned to the other man and said, would you please come with me, because this man needs some assistance. He said, turned to me and he said, Bill, we'll see you and Ellen later, and I'll catch up on what's going on. So the four of us left, and the two men went over. And the last thing I saw of them was they were taking the man into the restaurant. Later that week, we learned what had occurred. Our two friends went with this man into the restaurant and bought him dinner. They also found out that he needed a place to stay, so they took him to a motel and checked him in, and they walked with him to his room, and they went inside. They asked him if they could join him in the room, and the man agreed. And once in the room, they asked him if he needed anything else, and he explained that he had come to Charleston to get a job. He'd come for an interview, and he'd been there the entire week, and he took everything he had and put it into getting this job, and he didn't get the job. So now he's in Charleston. He has no money. He has no way to get back home. He doesn't have any way to get food, and he has no way to get shelter. And he runs into these two gentlemen. Well, they immediately called and bought a bus ticket for the next morning. And then they asked him if they could pray with him. And he said, certainly. And they prayed for him. They prayed for his safety. They prayed for him to be able to find employment, all those kinds of things. And when they finished the prayer, the man admitted that he wasn't much of a churchgoer. And he really didn't know much about Jesus at all. And he had never accepted Christ into his life. So these two men asked this gentleman if he wanted to know more. And the man said yes. So as a result, they spent several hours in conversation with him. They told him about Jesus, and he would ask questions and they would answer him to the best of their ability. And the man finally asked, how do I accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior? And they replied, just ask him in prayer. They stayed with him as he prayed, and then after they had finished, they went home. And that evening for them, these two men, was a very powerful and emotional moment. The next morning, they picked the man up from the motel, they drove him to the bus station, they gave him some money for the trip, and they stayed with him until the bus exited the station. And they never saw him again. 4 years ago, I learned that I had an unidentified nodule in the lower part of my right lung. The doctor suggested I get a CT scan of my chest area. The results of that scan showed that I had not one, but 8 small nodules scattered throughout my lungs. On the day the doctor told me the results of the scan, I left his office quite shaken. I was walking toward the elevator, and I saw a man standing at the door already. And I was wearing my clerical clothes, and I thought the man had gone in and gone down. When I got there, he was holding the door open for me. When I stepped inside, he said to me, "You don't need to be looking down. You need to be looking up. You need to be looking up to God." And I turned to him and said, "I know, but I just found out some news that I'm trying to process." And he replied very gently but directly, "It doesn't matter. You need to be looking up to God. God's going to take care of you. You need to be looking at Him. So don't look down. Look up." When the elevator stopped and we exited, he said once more, "You just keep looking up." I walked out to my truck, I got in the driver's seat, and I broke down and wept. Of course, I've never seen that man again. These events for me mirror the event in Acts between Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch. Philip is led by the Spirit to go to a certain place on the road from Jerusalem to Gaza. And on the road, he saw this man sitting and reading the book of Isaiah. He had just left Jerusalem, this man had, and he went there to where he had gone there to worship in the temple. And Philip strikes up a conversation with this man and learns that he is having trouble understanding the passage of Isaiah that he's reading. When Philip starts the conversation, the man asks him to sit with him and explain the passage to him. And as we heard the passage, the eunuch was reading in Isaiah was, "He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. Who can speak of his descendants? For his life was taken from him." And the passage definitely describes Jesus. Philip, having been led by the Spirit, has the opportunity to share with this man who Jesus is and what he has accomplished for every single person. With this new understanding, as they are traveling along the road, they come upon some water. And the eunuch asks if he could not be baptized. And Philip baptizes him. And at that moment, Philip is taken away by the Spirit. You see, his ministry to this man was now complete. Truthfully, in many Bible studies concerning this passage, the last section of the reading causes some issues for some people. In fact, that's the only part of the reading they want to concentrate on. They get caught in the sudden disappearance of Philip after the baptism. And I understand that it is odd and maybe hard to comprehend, but the important aspects of this reading are, first, that the Spirit was leading Philip to meet this man. Second, Philip responded to the opportunity to tell this man about Jesus. And finally, the man desired to be baptized, and Philip baptized him. These actions are exactly what Jesus has instructed the disciples to do. They were to go into the world as the Spirit leads them. They were to teach and preach about Jesus, telling the people that they met all that they had seen and heard from the beginning of Jesus' ministry to the resurrection. And they were to baptize those who believed. Now, the two stories I shared with you at the beginning of this sermon are modern-day examples of this reading. The two men responded to a man in need. They ministered to him. Then they told him about Jesus, and they prayed with him to accept Jesus as their Lord, as his Lord and Savior. They continued to minister him the following day, but then he was gone, and they've never seen each other again. But they responded as the Spirit led them. The man in the elevator ministered to me when I was downhearted. He saw that I was upset and confused, but he took the opportunity to remind me that God was with me. You see, there are times when we are the ministers, and there are times when we are the ones being ministered to. In all cases, it is the Spirit that is leading and guiding. In all cases, a response is required by one to minister to the other. And in all cases, one's faith is confirmed, strengthened, and renewed. You see, we are all followers of Christ, which means that the Holy Spirit is with us. The Holy Spirit is as close to us as a breath. And all we have to do is go where the Spirit leads us. Because the Spirit is going to lead us into opportunities to share our faith with others in gentle, loving ways. We are asked to be bold when we see and we hear the concerns of the people around us. We are to reach out to them as Christ has reached out to us. And when the ministry is accomplished, when our task is completed, we give the glory to God. We may never see that person again, but we have done what God wants us to do at that place, at that time, with that person. And if we do these things, when our own day on this earth is done, we might hear these words: "Well done, good and faithful servant." Amen. Would you please stand and turn to page 6 in your bulletin, or page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer, and let us reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our Savior was crucified, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let the light of heaven will shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
And give us all who share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
We pray for those on the parish prayer list, on the Daughters of the King prayer list, and for those who are foremost on our hearts and minds this day. For Jeannie, Tom and Marie, Tim and Amy, Bill and Jean, Lynn, Ann, Dottie, Joan, Jerry, Penny, Mike, David, John, we ask you, Lord, to touch them with your healing hand and restore them to health and wholeness of mind, body, and spirit in accordance with their needs and in accordance with your will. We ask for protection for all those who are on the front lines of the pandemic. We pray for those who are in our school systems. We ask, Lord, that you protect them and keep them safe from all harm. We also give thanks for those celebrating birthdays in the coming week, especially Mike Henderson. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to hold him in the hollow of your loving hand, where he may continue to grow in his knowledge and love of you. Heavenly Father, you have promised to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, nor as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have not done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may dwell in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. Greet one another in the name of the Lord. The peace of the Lord be always with you. And also with you. Please be seated. Just have one quick question. Has everybody gotten communion from the back if they so desire? God, please do so. The offertory sentence today is from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 12th chapter, the first verse. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father, Almighty Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us, and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffer and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament, serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and in the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let's be in peace. Hallelujah.
Please join me in the office day. O Lamb of God, that takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, that takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. O Lamb of God, that takes away the sins of the world, grant us peace. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed all men in your hearts by faith. Please join me in the prayer for spiritual communion. Dear Jesus, I believe that you are truly blessed and the Holy Spirit. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you within my soul. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people, gathered around Mary. Church, and I embrace you with all the affections of my soul, never permitting you to be separated from me. Amen. Amen. Please receive the sacrament. Blessing.